Hello, everyone, and welcome to this segment of One on One. I'm Martin Faulce. When we come back from the break, I know you've seen this guy around. You probably heard him sing at least once or twice. Errol Trusclair joins us right here on One on One right after the break. Don't go away.
Don't give up. At Waits and Downer Law Firm, we want to make sure that you have all the facts when dealing with your insurance company. We have the legal experience and ability to make them pay. Get the help you need. At Waits and Downer, it's our goal to not only get you a full damage recovery, but to get the insurance company to reimburse your legal fees. Call today for a free consultation. We are local and we are here to stay. Let our years of experience work for you.
Terrebonne General Health System, where medical science meets the art of caring, is committed to providing the latest advances in medical technology with a gentle, caring touch. This is evident in our high-tech, high-touch approach to healthcare. As a trusted healthcare resource, we deliver both life-saving, compassionate inpatient services and life-changing preventive care, while also providing wellness needs and outreach throughout the Bayou region. To learn about how Terrebonne General is providing innovative healthcare solutions, visit tghealthsystem.com.
And welcome back to One on One. As promised, Mr. Errol Trusclair, first of all, we appreciate you being on One on One.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
Anytime. I know that many people recognize the face. They know the name.
Oh, yeah.
And you played to a lot of audiences. But before we get into the music part of your life, take us way back to the early days of Errol Trusclair. What's the earliest years you remember?
I can remember the second and third grade, I went to St. Francis,
all right.
You know, the old boys' school.
Right.
And I remember being in a singing contest.
Really?
I was in the third or fourth grade, and I went to the Catholic school and got an education there. And my father worked for Halliburton, and he was gone quite a bit. And I have two brothers, one older and one younger. And, you know, pretty much my father was gone quite a bit, but you know, my mother took care of us, and I had a great upbringing and a great childhood and a great family life, you know.
You seem to enjoy life. Did that go back to those days? Were you a happy kid?
Oh yeah, certainly. Yeah. I was born and raised on Wright Street, which is by the West Park School, and I can remember having all my friends, you know, they were the same age as me. We used to run around barefooted with no shirt on, and in the summertime, and just having a great time fishing and doing whatever we wanted to do.
So you say even back then, you were singing. So you knew pretty early on that somewhere music was going to be involved in your life.
Yeah, I guess so. I never was aware of it. That I would do it professionally until I was like about 15. When I was, I think, 13 or 14, my daddy bought a piano, old upright piano. And my older brother was in a band. And the piano player, they used to practice in my living room. And of course, I was right there like a chicken hawk watching, you know? the piano player showed me some few little notes on the piano, and I just started playing. And then we formed our own group, and I've been playing ever since.
Hey, your brother plays with you, too.
My brother plays saxophone with me. Leroy's been with me since the early 60s, I guess, yeah.
Right.
He had his own band, and I had mine. And when their band split up in mine, we kind of joined up together, you know, and we've been playing on and off ever since. Maybe we'll play together for a year or two, and then first thing you know, here we are playing together again. He's been playing steady with me now for about 3 years.
I'll watch you when you're performing. Not only are you a good musician and a good singer, but you're a good entertainer. You know
Thank
how
you.
To entertain.
Thank you.
Where does that come from? Is it years of practice, or did you inherit that?
I guess it's inherited. It's just a matter of I enjoy it so much, you know, and people tell me, you know, it's it's really a shame that they pay you, you know, because you really ought to be playing for free because you're having so much fun. Yeah. You know, I'll turn around and look at the drummer and everybody's smiling and laughing and cutting up and having a good time. And it just kind of radiates to the people, you know, and we just really have a good time when we play. The money's nice, but that's never been a factor, you know. People used to call me and want to book me for a job, and I just tell them where, they just tell me where and when. I never even ask them how much, you know. We just all showed up and played.
You get there and negotiate later, huh? Yeah. Pay me whatever you think I'm worth, huh?
Yeah, but it's been a love of my life since, you know, for most of my life, and it's just something that's inside of you. You know, my wife, if you keep asking me, she says, "Errol, when are you going to retire?" And I said, "When it quits being fun."
Yeah.
You know, when it quits being enjoyable, you know.
I was talking about Miss Shanna. In her own right, she would be a good one for 1-1 because she's been supportive of you, but she's been pretty successful too.
Very, very, very successful. She started out with a company called HWI over on Hollywood Road with Gerald Loring and Tommy Parkhill. She was one of the first employees. And she just kind of grew with the company, and they were bought out by Brown Oil Tools bought them out, and then she worked for them for about 3 years, and then Tommy and Gerald started their own company, HWC, right. And she went to work for them, and just worked her way up. She was vice president, executive secretary, and just traveled all over the world, and just had a really, really great working relationship with him, you know. She pretty much kind of, they did the work and she managed the company and the people and the money,
right.
You know.
you seem to me at least to be relaxed in general. You know, I've interviewed a lot of people. You sat down here, we were talking for a show. This is no big deal to you. You seem to be relaxed in general.
Well, I guess it's just my makeup, you know. Everybody tells me I'm laid back. I guess I am, you know, that's just how I am. I just I don't worry about a whole lot of things. I just kind of let things flow. That's part of the chemistry of the band. My guitar player, Mr. Carl Kimball, who was a city marshal,
right.
Who's been a dear, dear friend of mine for years, besides being a great guitarist. Right. And he tells me, he says, "Errol, I love playing with you," because he said, it's a free thing, you know, nothing is regimented, you know. We may play a song 10 times and play it differently every time. And I just tell them to watch me, they just key off of me, and everything just seems to flow, you know.
And that's the chemistry between you all.
That's the chemistry, exactly.
You
know, that's a
good
way
to put it. If you brought in a new guitar player tomorrow and you went off on a tangent, he or she wouldn't know where you're going, right?
That's a very good analogy, yeah, right, yeah. But we've been together so long that it's scary sometimes where I think, especially Don, my drummer, Don Prosperi, works for Southland Dodge. He's been with me since he got out of high school in the late 70s. Sometimes I think he can read my mind.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can just turn around and look at him, and he just knows what I'm going to do. scary sometimes.
Either you're turning around and looking at him because of a note or because somebody in the audience is really acting kooky, right?
or sometimes we want to extend a song, or want my brother to take another ride, another solo,
right.
And I'll just turn around and nod it to him, and just, you know, everything just seems to flow. You know, we just never have any problems.
You were one of the first to play on our Laid Back program.
Yeah, that was, about 15 years ago, if I remember, maybe 12, 15 years ago. Yeah.
And I just remember the excitement that came out of you, and the people loved you up there. So it seems to be a natural thing between you and the audience.
Yeah, I guess so. You know, I noticed when the people are in the audience and they're dancing, they seem to be having a good time. They're looking at me and they're smiling. Right. So I guess everything's okay, you know.
Well, I remember that show because I remember everybody started dancing. It wasn't supposed to be a dance program because we had cameras everywhere.
Right.
And all of a sudden people started dancing. And I just remember our camera guys were going through havoc because people were dancing over their cables and everything else. And at one point we threw our hands up and said, "We can't stop it.
Let it happen,
it's
right.
It's a movement."
Yeah. Yeah, you know, we do, you know, when people call me to book me, they ask me what kind of music I play. I said, you know, we play 50s and 60s and blues and rock and roll. But I said, what we do, we keep the people dancing. So if you want a band that's going to make the people dance, I'm your band. You know, we just, the people have always danced our music. It's been like that for a lot of years.
This was your first CD you put out recently?
Yeah.
That's shocking that you finally put out a CD, but that it was your only CD.
Well, you know, when we first started playing music, we approached it in a way where we just played, and I just never have thought about it. And I'm gonna tell you a quick story. I can thank my lovely wife for it. She walked up to me about a year or so ago and said, Errol, you know, if you quit playing or if you pass away or something happens to you, you know, your kids are going to ask, your grandkids are going to ask you, what kind of music you play? And it got me to thinking. So this past Christmas, she presented me with an envelope, and it had a recording session. It had a thing for a recording session. She went to Pershing Wells. I'm sure you're very...
Yeah, talented guy.
Very, extremely, did a very good job. And he played with me at one time when we had the band called Moss Point in the late 60s, early 70s, which I'm sure you remember.
Yeah.
I got together and with Pershing, and we started, you know, deciding what songs we were going to play. And everything worked out well. You know, another aspect I want to mention is that all of the musicians that I've known over the years, they all came and they offered their services.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it just warmed my heart. I mean, you know, guys came from Baton Rouge, from Lafayette, you know, with the Boogie Kings, with Blue Eyed Soul, with the Soul Survivors, and everybody offered their musical talent. And when I went to pay them, nobody wouldn't take any money. You know, I had a checkbook. I was going to write them a check. No, Errol.
But maybe you brought back memories for them too.
That's highly possible. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was just a really heartwarming thing, and it was a really warm and wonderful thing.
Structural heart disease refers to a defect in the heart's valves, walls, or chambers that keeps the heart from pumping blood properly. Valve or structural heart problems may be present at birth or develop over time. Your risk increases if you have high blood pressure, plaque buildup, history of heart attack, take certain medications, or have certain heart infections. The Structural Heart Program at CIS and Terrebonne General provides innovative solutions and devices with the latest technology to bring the best possible outcomes for patients. Learn more at cardio.com.
New Honda inventory now at Barker Honda.
Well, they're here and the lot's filling up fast.
And we have more coming in every day at Barker. On your cars, HRVs, CRVs, and Civics.
We have Pilots, Passports, and Odysseys now in stock.
So come on by to Barker Honda and take advantage of our amazing deals, and you'll see why.
It's better at Barker.
So your wife gives you an envelope with a recording session. What she was basically telling you is, your legacy is in music and it's not selling cars. Even though that's how you made your living, she was telling you, I want everyone to remember you by the way they remember you, playing music,
right.
Singing.
Exactly. And to have something, you know, 30 years from now, somebody can say, well, yeah, I remember him. You know, with a CD, you know, I'm really grateful for what she did. I can't thank her enough. You know, she's been my heart and soul and my love for over 40 years.
Right.
And I really don't know what I'd do without her. She's I call her my baby, you know.
Yeah. What's the funniest thing you've seen in the audience?
Funniest thing I've seen in the audience?
I know you've had to see some sights over the years.
Oh, yeah. Just people that drink too much, and naturally when they drink too much, they think they're invisible. You know, you get it, like the old saying, you get invisible and bulletproof and good looking, right. And do some really crazy things on the dance floor.
Right.
And sometimes do some things they shouldn't do, right. You know, and I just sit back and smile. You know, it's unbelievable, you know.
But if, I mean, I'm sure y'all have a code now between the band. I'm sure every now and then when that happens, you do that little look back to the band, and I'm sure you get the eyes back from them. I'm sure at some points it gets pretty comical.
Oh, sometimes we laugh so hard that it interrupts the song. You know, I'll just quit singing and just laughing, and the boys in the band are just cracking up. They're in stitches. We're laughing so hard. You know, it's just really funny. You know,
when Gatorin' first started.
Oh my God! Yes.
I guess Gatorin' must be the thing that stuck for the longest amount of years, because I think at parties people still gator.
At parties, yeah. You know, when we play for private parties, I've been doing this for, you know, for over 40 years, and it always starts out very quiet, very mellow, and there's just a murmur in the audience, and they're sipping their toddies and eating their finger food and doing what they got to do. The first set's always very mellow and very quiet.
Right.
And then the second set gets a little louder, and then the third and fourth set, everybody's, you know, had a few drinks and they're loose, and the gatoring starts, you
and
know.
And then the dim on the lights goes down a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
When them lights go dim, the dance floor is packed, huh?
Oh, yeah. And usually the last set. We usually play from 9 to 1. That's most of, sometimes we play from 8 to 12, but it's mostly 9 to 1.
But that's a pretty good set, 4 hours.
4 hours is a, yeah, it's we usually take 2 breaks. We play about an hour, hour and a half, and we take a 15, 20 minute break. And we come back and we play to 11:45. And then we'll come back around midnight and play from midnight to 1. And that's when the fun usually starts, right. You know. I've been doing this so long that it's just part of it, you know. Some people tell me the band just play a 45 minute set.
Yeah. You're just getting warmed up by then, huh?
Yeah.
Let me ask you this, and don't give me the answer yet, because I want a chance to answer this question to see if I'm even close. The most requested song over your career, am I close if I say Brown Eyed Girl?
You hit the nail on the head.
Is that the most, every time I go to a function, Brown Eyed Girl, Brown Eyed Girl, Brown Eyed Girl.
We usually play it the first set, and then we usually have to play it again in the last set. We usually do it twice a night.
You don't get tired of hearing that song?
Sometimes, yeah, you know, yeah. Sometimes it gets a little boring, but you know, you're playing for the people,
right.
And if that's what the people want to hear, you know, you just have to do it. You know, It's not like you're playing for yourself, you know. You're playing, I guess what I'm trying to say is you have to enjoy. If I didn't enjoy it, I wouldn't do it. But you're playing for the people, and if, you know, people come up to me all night long and request that song, and I say, well, we just played it, and some of them understand, but some of them get a little huffy about it, you know, and sometimes they'll come up to me and ask me to play a song, and I don't know it. And they get frustrated, you know. They say, "What do you mean you don't know that song?" Well, there's 200 million songs, you know.
You know. Has it ever come close to a knockdown drag out because somebody got angry?
No, I've had a couple of people got real ugly, and I just tell them, "Listen, I'm sorry, I don't know your song. I apologize, but how about if I play this for you?"
Right.
You know, and they'll say, most of the time, I've had a couple of people got really ugly, but you know, most of the time you can suggest a song that's pretty comparable to what they're requesting, and they'll be happy, unless they're just totally intoxicated, you know.
Yeah, you're right.
Then there's no reasoning with them then, you know.
What's your favorite song?
My favorite song is Georgia by Ray Charles.
That would fit you well.
Yeah, I've been doing that song for a long time, and it's also my CD. We had a guy do the arrangement for us on that song. We have about 8 or 10 horns, and the arrangement really came out nice. And Ray Charles has been probably my favorite single performer since I've been a kid, you know. I just there's just something about him that just gets inside of me and just makes me warm all over, you know. He's just a great musician, great songwriter. Just the way he attacks a song, the way he phrases it is just unbelievable.
The next 10 years, what do you see yourself? Still playing through those 10 years, still entertaining?
That's a difficult question to answer. Depending how my voice holds up, depending how my health holds up, you know, if as long as I'm healthy and my voice holds up, and the people keep calling, I guess I'll play, you know?
If the phone keeps ringing and you keep booking it,
huh? Yeah.
Brown Eyed Girl, I guess we're going to hear it a few thousand more times.
I guess a few hundred more times, yeah.
All right. If you had to, if I went to Miss Shanna, if I went to Johnny, if I went to just Raul Doria and your core group of guys you hang around with in the neighborhood, I probably, if I start naming them, I'm going to miss a few Darryl Brew and all that gang. And I said, all right, I'm never going to tell Errol how you describe him, but I want one word that would describe Errol Trostclair, but I won't tell him what you said. What's that true one word that they would give me to describe you?
Happy-go-lucky. You know? Just kind of a free-flowing thing, kind of a free-flowing guy. We have a really good time, and you know, we always cut up. They call me the old man of the group, you know, and then all kind of nicknames, which I can't say on the air. Yeah. But we have a great time, and I really enjoy my friendship with these guys.
Mm-hmm.
We play golf as often as we can together. And as a matter of fact, we're going to Reno, Nevada, with the group from Ellendale at the end of this month, and the whole group's coming with us. We're going to have a really good time.
I was with Darryl Brew on the boat for the Blessing of the Fleet the other day, and
mm-hmm.
His blank in my mind. He told me to call you a nickname, and I cannot remember what he told me. But does it come to mind a nickname that he calls you all the time?
He calls me the Midget.
The Midget?
The Midget, because I'm so short. and he's such a huge guy, you know?
Right.
And he's 6'3", 6'2", about 200.
Former football player.
Former LSU. He bleeds purple and gold, definitely.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. They've even got me being an LSU fan now, you know?
All right.
Which I was before, but now it's a little more intense, you know? And I always play in the LSU golf tournament. In fact, we did it 2 weeks ago
mm-hmm.
with the guy. They always have LSU alumni as the fifth guy, and then he invites the four people.
Okay.
So it's a fivesome, and it's a best ball thing. It's fun. I've been doing that for about 8 or 10 years with him now.
If somebody's watching and they want to get a copy of your CD, can they go online and get it? Or do you just sell them out the car or wherever you play?
They can come to my used car lot, which is E.T.'s Automotive at 1323 Barrow.
Okay.
Or they can go to my daughter's and my wife's shoe store at Shoe Fits.
Okay.
And they're also on sale at the mall.
Okay.
At Louisiana thing?
Louisiana, little Cajun store.
Yeah, the little Cajun store.
Right. Okay.
And, you know, and wherever we're playing, I've always got a box full of them.
All right.
And anybody who wants one, all they got to do is give me a call.
All right.
And I'll be happy to bring it to you, or put it in the mail, or you can come get it, or whatever, you know. I think if they listen to it, they'll really get the spirit of what I've done in the past years, you know.
Well, Mr. Happy-Go-Lucky, we appreciate what you've done in the area, and I know just several people I've talked to over the years that, seeing you entertain people, I want to thank you for what you've done, because you've done a heck of a job making people laugh and keeping people singing. And
thank you.
That's a talent you have, and we appreciate what you brought to the area.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I've really enjoyed it, and it's been a pleasure. you know, and I just hope I can just keep going, you know, as long as, like I said, as long as I'm able, as long as my voice holds up and my health holds up, I'll be there.